reminders of that. April's second mile giving beneficiary is the Lutheran Disaster Response. And because of our benevolence that we give to the Synod, 100% of contributions to the Lutheran Disaster Response actually go to helping people in need in those areas. Our food pantry continues to do well, serving people, probably about between 140 families right now on a monthly basis. And if you would like to support that financially, you are welcome to make a gift to that through our church. If you're looking for a Bible study, we continue our Stories from Matthew's Gospel this Wednesday at 6:30 on Zoom. And just send me a message through email, or give me a phone call or something, but I'll need your email address to send you the invitation to the Bible study. And there's going to be a spring cleanup on May 1st. It's a Saturday, first Saturday of May, beginning at it's going to be an outside cleanup primarily, and I think our CYFM committee is also going to do some cleanup upstairs in their areas. So be a nice day of service for us. I hope it doesn't rain. So we're not asking you to sign up, but to just show up if you're interested. Give an hour or two. It's going to go from 9 o'clock to, I think, 1 o'clock. So any time that you can allot for that would be greatly appreciated. And with all that being shared, I invite us to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We are gathered in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor, and enter this celebration of Easter reconciled with God and one another. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned and cannot free ourselves. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your way.
By grace, we have been saved and our sins forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Christ is risen indeed.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Stand before the apostles who prayed and laid their hands on them.
word of God continued to spread. The number of the disciples increased greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. Stephen, full of grace and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. And some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, Cyrenians, Alexandrians, and others of those from Cilicia and Asia, stood up and argued with Stephen, but they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he spoke. Then they secretly instigated some men to say, "We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God." He stirred up the people, as well as the elders and the scribes. Then they suddenly confronted him, seized him, and brought him before the council. They set up false witnesses who said, "This man never stopped saying things against his holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and change the customs that Moses handed on to us." And all who sat in the council looked intently at him, and they saw that his face was like the face of the angel. Then the high priest asked him, "Are these things so?" And Stephen replied, "Brothers and fathers, listen to me. The God of glory appeared to our ancestor Abraham. Our ancestor had this tent of testimony in the wilderness, as God directed when he spoke to Moses, ordering him to make it according to the pattern he had seen. Our ancestors in turn brought it in with Joshua, when he disposed the nations that God drove out before our ancestors. And it was there until the time of David, who found favor with God and asked that he might find a dwelling place for the house of Jacob. But it was Solomon who built a house for him. Yet the Most High does not dwell in houses made with human hands, as the prophet says, 'Heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool.' What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? What is the place of my rest? Did not my hand make all these things? You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you are forever opposing the Holy Spirit, just as your ancestors used to do. Which of the prophets did your ancestors not persecute? He killed those who foretold the coming of the righteous one. And now you have become his betrayers and murderers. You are the ones that received the law as ordained by angels, and yet you have not kept it." When they heard these things, they became enraged and ground their teeth at Stephen. But filled with the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they covered their ears. With a loud shout, all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he died. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Have we heard someone say that they would like to be like Jesus? How often have we thought or said that ourselves? I just want to be like Jesus. about when James and John fought between themselves about who would sit at the right hand of Jesus. And Jesus telling them that they didn't know what they were asking. And today we have one of the clearest examples of being like Jesus in the trial and martyrdom of Stephen. He knew what he was asking. Just like Jesus, Stephen was a man full of the Spirit, full of grace and power, and performed great wonders and signs. And just like Jesus, Stephen faced opposition that sought to put him to death based on false charges and testimony. And just like Jesus, Stephen refused to back down from his mission. If you've never read Stephen's sermon to the Sanhedrin, I encourage you to take a few minutes this week and read it. It's in chapter 7 of Acts. It was the part in between what we heard today that was left out, for the most part. It's a wonderful summary, of how God's presence and action has never been restricted to any one building, land, or people. Stephen reminds us that God has worked in many places and in many ways through many people. In it, we are reminded that God called Abraham out of the land of the Chaldeans to Haran, then to the Promised Land. God worked in and through Egypt during the famine under Joseph. How God worked with and through Moses while in Egypt and in Midian. How God dwelt on Sinai while Israel rebelled in idolatry at the base of the mountain. How God dwelt in the tabernacle throughout the wilderness, and even when Israel finally settled in the Promised Land. And how God then dwelt in the Temple of Solomon. What Stephen so skillfully did was to point out from Scripture that God's power and actions are not tied to just one building, the temple in Jerusalem. It never has been, and it never will be. God works through a variety of people in a variety of places, including outside of the church building. Finally, Stephen gives us one last reminder from God's own mouth that his presence and action isn't limited to houses made by human hands. Stephen does all of this through Scripture, reminding the Sanhedrin that Moses predicted a prophet would come that would be like him. That righteous one is the very Jesus they had condemned to death. He then calls this assembly out on their sinful resistance of the Holy Spirit and their rejection of Jesus. And they killed him. It's always a tragedy when people ignore the word of God, but even more so when it leads to violence. Stephen's defense was nothing but quoted Scripture of how God had worked in the past, and a claim that God works the same way today. He points out the inconsistency of the Sanhedrin by denying the Holy Spirit's working in the world, and how their ancestors ignored the word of God as well. The rejection of Stephen's testimony was a rejection of God's work in the world, just as it was when they rejected Jesus. God's work for a variety of people in a variety of places, including outside of the church building. And that was a message that the Sanhedrin refused to hear. Stephen's death looked at as just a tragedy. When evil people intended to silence Christianity through violence, God used their actions to bring salvation to the ends of the earth, just like God did through Jesus. In short, God chose to work through a variety of people in a variety of places, and this event put things into motion outside of their church building. You see, the intense persecution that broke out because of Stephen's spirit-fueled sermon caused Christians to flee Jerusalem. And while we might think this is a bad thing, God again used it powerfully to take the gospel into a variety of places. So, when we say we want to be like Jesus, are we prepared to endure evil people? Are we prepared to endure people telling lies about us and about the gospel we preach? Are we prepared to share the word of God, even when it means being persecuted? Are we willing to speak out about social injustice in the face of violent reaction? Are we willing to work to end poverty, oppression, racism, and any other acts of injustice, even when we could possibly be stoned because of it? Being like Jesus will at times require us to step outside of our comfort zones, to step into the shoes of other human beings and walk a mile or two with them. Being like Jesus will at times require us to be in the line of fire for standing up for the truth and not necessarily popular opinion. Are we still willing to be like Jesus? Let us succumb to the Holy Spirit within us to strengthen us for the journey. And the people of God said,
Amen.
before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Living God, in the midst of Easter joy, we are still filled with questions and wondering. Open our hearts and minds as we encounter the scriptures, so that the church embodies repentance and forgiveness. In the name of Jesus, to all nations, hear us, O God.
Mercy and grace.
God of all, the nations hunger and thirst for your righteousness. Many call on you for guidance and strength. Answer their hopes with the peace of Christ, and give your loving kindness to national, state, and local leaders. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Loving parent, you have given us such love that we should be called the children of God. Reveal yourself to us so that we in this community of faith will become more and more like you in our mutual love and bold witness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We confess, repent, and reject the times when we as a church and as individuals have been silent in the face of racial injustice. Heal the hearts of those affected by racism in our community and worldwide. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Healing God, you hear the cries of those in need and answer them in their distress. Grant those who are sick and suffering your compassion, especially those on our prayer list and those we now name in your presence. Nurse them back to health and wholeness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In thanksgiving and remembrance, we recall the lives and gifts of those who now live in endless joy, especially Walter Servick, Raymond Klein, Ethel Roberts, Mary Taylor, Doris Peterson, Emily Manger, and Leo Schrock. Unite us with them in resurrection hope. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for peace in the world and for the safety of all military personnel, especially those who have congregational ties. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us offer to one another a sign of Christ's peace. Thank you.
have raised us to new life in Christ.
Give us a heart that God gave us, even as you gave all of us. So may we give all to you. And may we not give out of our abundance, but out of our poverty. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and
Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us pray with confidence, as Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The risen Christ invites us to this table. Come, eat, and be satisfied.
Take away.
body of Christ given for you, Joyce. The body of Christ given for you, surely. The body of Christ given for you, Jim. Thank you.
send us in the power of your Spirit, that our lives bear witness to the love that has made us new in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
May our glorious God grant us a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And I do hope you all have a great and blessed week.